So, dear students, earlier we have discussed that what factors determine the price elasticity of demand, and in those factors we have discussed three factors basically. One is necessities versus luxuries, and second is availability of close substitute, and the third is narrow markets and broad markets, how they affect the price elasticity of demand. So now we are going to discuss the fourth factor that going to affect the price elasticity of demand. That factor is known as time horizon. How time horizon going to affect the price elasticity of demand? So in this way, suppose that goods, especially in case of time horizon factor, those goods, that type of goods tend to have more elastic demand over longer time horizon. When the price of gasoline or petroleum product rises, the quantity of gasoline demand falls only slightly in the first few months. So in the first few months, the demand of gasoline or petroleum falls slightly, but in the first few months. Over time, however, people buy more fuel efficient cars, switch to public transport, and more closer to where they work. Means they are switched to more they are start switching their residence, and they are starting to find the places that are more closer to their workplace. So within several years, the quantity of petrol or gasoline demand fall substantially. So in case of time horizon, the first impact is that there is a slight change in the quantity demanded of petrol or gasoline, but over time, after some time, after 3-4 month or after a short time period, in a long run, people divert from the cars that are more fuel efficient, and they starting switching to the public transportation instead of the private transportation, and they trying to find the places which are more closer to their workplace. So after a long time, within a few several years, what is going to be happen? People switch from gasoline to other options, and hence the quantity demanded changes substantially. So over the time, the impact of change in prices of gasoline comes after several years or over the time. You cannot see the impact of change in prices suddenly, but it will take some time. So now these are the factors that basically determines the price elasticity of demand. So I hope you understand that what are those factors that basically affect the price elasticity of demand. But there are other factors as well. In real life, there are numerous factors that impact the price elasticity of demand. Some are external factor, or you can say outside factor, that come into the picture. We have no idea that these factors are going to affect the price elasticity of demand, because these are the external factor, natural calamity, any disaster, these are any pandemic. These are the external factor that are going to affect the price elasticity of demand of any specific good. So before discussing the price elasticity of demand, I like to discuss with you there are different ways to calculate the price elasticity of demand. So first I am going to discuss with you that how basically we can calculate the elasticity, then what are the problem in those measures, and then why we moved towards the midpoint method due to the problem of other methods. So the basic formula of price elasticity of demand is percentage change in quantity demanded divided by percentage change in price. That means you have to first calculate the percentage change in quantity demanded, and then you have to calculate the percentage change in price, and then you are going to divide those percentage changes in quantity demanded prices, and then you are able to get the value of price elasticity of demand. Okay, and then here you can see that in this graph. when the price is we already knew that price and quantity have the negative relationship, that's why we have a negatively slow demand curve. So here the price is when price is P1, the quantity demanded is greater, and as the prices increases, the demand for good is shows the declining trend. So here the here we can see that the price although increased 10%, but the fall in quantity demand is 15%, which is more than one. As you see, it is 1.5%. So it shows that the good has the characteristics of elastic demand, because people show the substantial change in quantity demand due to increase in prices. So as we have discussed that we are only going to, in case of elasticity, we are only going to discuss the because price and demand have quantity demand has a negative relationship. So that's why we in some cases the elasticity, even after the calculation of price elasticity of demand, you might get the values in negative with negative signs. So what you have to do is you have to ignore the negative sign and you consider it as a positive number. Means you have to only took you are going to take the elasticity in IS absolute term. So this is the standard formula in order to calculate the percentage change. The standard method of percentage change is N value, which is also known as in other several textbook it is also known as current value minus start value. Start value means previous value divided by start value, or previous value you can say. So N value minus start value divided by start value multiplied by 100. So you are going to get the percentage change, either it would be a quantity or price. So first we are going to take the example of price. So here price, if we and basically in this example I'm going to show you what is the problem in this formula, why we convert why we are going instead of opting this formula, why we are using the midpoint method in order to calculate the price elasticity of demand. You can see here, like if like in this case, if we are going from point A to B, you can see, and now we have to first we have to calculate the percentage change in prices. So first the price is first the price is $200, and then seller increase the price of any specific good. So you can say now the price is 250. When the price is $200, the quantity demand is 12 units of any good. You can suppose any good, like right now we are talking in right now I'm going to give you the example in a general term where we are not specifically discussing any good. So here when the price is 200 units, so the quantity demanded is 12. So now the price increases from 252 to 200 to $250, and the demand and the quantity demand is now $8. So first we have to calculate the percentage change in prices. So here we are going to calculate the percentages in prices by using this formula. Here end value, right now the current value basically is 250. Now the prices are, instead of 200, it is 250. So here we write in case of end value we are going to write 250, and in case of start value, which is the basically the previous value, here we write the earlier prices which are $200, and then divided by $200, which is the previous value or start value, and multiply by 100. The answer we are going to get is the 25%. Okay, when we are going to divide, we are going to get the 25%. Okay, and then here they mention that the standard method gives different answer depending on your on where you start. Like if I, instead of starting from, if I'm going to suppose that the prices, instead of the current prices, instead here in previous example we suppose that the here we suppose that the current prices or end value is 250. So here, instead of supposing that the end value or start current value is 250, if I am going to suppose that now the prices are decreases instead of increases. Like now the end value is 200 and the start value was 250, divided by 250, then we are going to get the different answer. This is the problem with this formula basically. So now instead we, if I'm going to suppose that now due to any reasons the price of any specific commodity is decreased. Before it was $250 and now it is $200, so, and the quantity demanded also increases from when it, the quantity demand is $250, when the price is $250, the quantity demand is 8 units of wood, and when the price is decreases, the quantity demand is 12 units of wood. So when you are going to change the end value and start value, you are going to get the different results. So this is the basically the problem with this standard formula. So and similarly, as you calculate the price elasticity of percentage change in prices, we are going to calculate the percentage change in quantity demanded. How we are going to do that? Similarly, here if I'm going to suppose that 250 here, we suppose that 250 is the current value. So here we are going to suppose that quantity 8 is the current value, and the quantity demanded for 12 unit of good is the previous value. So here what we are going to do, 8 minus 12 divided by 12. So this is the if we are going from point A to B. So now here we can see that from point A to B, price rises 25%, quantity falls 33%, and elasticity is 1.33%, which is greater than 1, means it is a elastic demand. If we are going if we are moved from B to A instead of A to B, if we are going to move B to A, the price falls 20%. When we move from A to B, price falls 25%, but in that case, when we move from B to A, the price fall 20%. So, and the quantity rises 50%, in case of A to B, quantity falls 33%. So elasticity is around 2.50 in this case. So we are here we are getting the different elasticity, although both of them are greater than 1, but the intensity is different. Here 1.3% and here 2.50. so this thing basically shows the problem in standard formula or standard method through which we are calculating the price elasticity of demand. So that's why the economist suggests that we have to move towards the another formula which is going to help us to calculate the exact or same number of price elasticity of demand. So so in this case, either we are moved from either we move from B to A or A to B, we are going to get the similar value. There should be a no difference in the elasticity. The value should be similar, either 1.33 or 2.1 or in between them 1.5. So either we move from A to B or B to B, the elasticity should be constant. So this is the problem in this formula. So that's why economists move towards the another formula which solves this problem. This is known as the midpoint method. So with the help of midpoint method, we are going to get this constant value, either we move from A to B or B to A. But they have done. So instead of using the standard method, the economists starting using the midpoint method due to the problem, due to the demerits that standard formula have. So the midpoint, what is midpoint? The midpoint is the number halfway between the start value and end value, the average of those value, you can say. It does not matter which value you use as the start and which value we are going to use as end. We are going to get the same answer either way. So here, if we are going to take the example of prices, so how we are going to use the midpoint formula in this case? Here we knew that in the previous example we have seen that the values will be remain same. In order to see the differences, how midpoint formula overcome the problem of standard formula. So the values we are going to take the similar value, and we are going to see that how midpoint method overcome the problems that contains the standard method of in order to calculate the price elasticity of demand. So here we have seen that the price is initially was $200 and then it is $250. The midpoint value in between these is 225. Okay, 225 basically is the midpoint, and in this case, in case of quantity demanded, the mid value is 10. Okay, so in this way you are going to do the midpoint method. So here, instead of writing the start value or previous value, we are going to put the midpoint value. So in that case, you can see here you can see that our current value or you can say the end value is $250 minus previous or start value is $200 divided by the mid value, which is in between these two values. It is 225, and multiply by 100, we are going to get the percentage change is 22.2. So in case of quantity demand, change in quantity demanded, we are going to the similar formula, and the mid value here, the midpoint here is a 10, and we get the percentage change in quantity demanded is around 40%. The price elasticity of demand equals 1.8%. So now either you are going towards A to B or B to A, you are going to get the similar value. Try to do the practice in your home and you get the a similar answer. This is the active learning. You have to do it by yourself. First you try to do it yourself, okay, and then if you have not been able to do this, I will give you the during the online session, I will give you some I'm going to solve one question. So with the help of this solution, you are going to do the further practice question. Okay, so this is the midpoint method basically. So I hope you understand. I'm going to give you the review regarding the midpoint method one more time, so if there is any problem you can understand. So the midpoint method, basically one way to avoid this is to use the one way to avoid the problem of standard formula of standard formula in order to calculate the price elasticity of demand is the midpoint method for calculating the elasticity. Rather than computing a percentage change using the standard way by dividing the percentage change by the initial value, or you can say a start value or a previous value, the midpoint method computes a percentage change by dividing the change by the midpoint of the initial and final level. I'm going to give you a simple example. For instance, suppose that $5 is the midpoint of $4 and $6. Okay, we suppose that there are two prices, $4 and $6, and in between the value is $5. So 5 is the midpoint method. So what you're going to see, we say that there are two prices, $4 and $6. Initial price or the previous price, or you can say the start value is $4 and the current value, or you can say the end value is $6. So according to midpoint method, what you are going to do, 6, which is the end value or a current value, minus 4, which is the previous value or the start value, divided by 5, which is the midpoint value. In between 6 and 4 we have 5. So what we are going to do, 6 minus 4 divided by 5, multiply by 100, we are going to get the 40 value. So this 40% is considered, you can consider as the 40% increase in the prices. And similarly, now you are going to change the $6 to $4. What you are going to do, previously what we have done, 6 minus 4 divided by 5, now you are going to do 4 minus 6 divided by 5, again you are going to get the 40%. But the value is now have the negative sign, that we have already discussed, that we have to ignore the negative sign and we only consider the positive value, and we are converting to the absolute value. So again it shows the 40% decrease in the prices. Okay, so similarly in case of quantity demanded, you have to do the same practice, and then the answer you are going to get, you some the percentage change in quantity demanded, and then the percentage in price, you simply going to divide that values and you are going to get the price elasticity of demand. Okay, so the midpoint method gives the some answer regardless of the direction of the change. Why we are using the midpoint method? Regardless of the direction of the change, either A to B or B to A, it will give us the right answer or a same answer. So this method is we are often used by for calculating the price elasticity of demand between 2 points. Okay, so this is basically the concept regarding the price midpoint method. The example I quote you is basically is from your textbook. So go, bache, go and see that chapter and try to. If you again you have any problem, then you are going in the online session you can ask the question regarding midpoint method. Okay, so this is the midpoint method. In the next lecture, I'm going to discuss with you the variety of demand curves. What are the variety of demand curves, like perfectly elastic, inelastic demand curve, and inelastic demand curve, elastic demand curve, perfectly elastic demand curve, unit elastic demand curve. So these are basically the variety of demand curve. So this this topic I'm going to cover in the next part. So bache, listen those lectures carefully and ask question.